House of Cards is brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store. Available in over 95 cities across North America, Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today. And now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizzly.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls,
you're listening to House of Cards.
Today, the game is different.
I want to gamble.
Gambling is a very serious business.
Is that clear?
Welcome to House of Cards. Dave Weishaupt with you here, deep from the swamps of Jersey. We got a great show coming up for you. Football season is here, and that means the sports betting community is ready to throw down some cash. It also means that the sportsbooks are making deals and spending some big money to get your business. I'm starting to see the brand new TV commercials right now. And when we want to get an update on the world of gambling and sports betting, we turn to one guy. Coming up, we're going to be talking with Adam Small from USBets.com and Better Collective to find out what the sportsbooks are doing for the upcoming football season. Deals are being made every day, and Adam's going to fill us in about what's going on. So stick around. We'll be right back with House of Cards.
I owed the IRS $10,000.
The IRS garnished my wages.
They put a lien on my house.
I'm self-employed and didn't report all my income. They claim I owe a lot more than I do.
The IRS is the most powerful collection agency in the world. They do not give up until you pay.
I couldn't sleep. We were being audited. I called Tax Solutions Now, and a great big weight was lifted off my shoulders.
I called Tax Solutions Now, and they got the IRS off my back.
Tax Solutions Now had my wage garnishment lifted in 48 hours.
Tax Solutions Now can get you help. Our agents know the rules, can stop the pain, and get you the best deal.
Tax Solutions Now saved my business.
I qualified for the Fresh Start program. I paid less than I owed.
We connect you with a team of former IRS agents and tax professionals who get the IRS off your back.
Time is running out. Call Tax Solutions Now.
Call 800-297-9788. 800-297-9788.
Psst. Yeah, you. Come here. Haven't you heard? We don't need to hide anymore.
Now, we can shop privately for adult products at adamandeve.com. They've got massage oils, lingerie, and lots more we can't mention here. Use offer code SPICE404. They'll give you 50% off almost any one item, 3 free DVDs, free mystery gift, and free shipping. That's 50% off, free shipping, and more. Private shopping starts at adamandeve.com.
Is your bathroom looking old and worn out? Want to update it, but you don't know where to start? Then let BCI Bath & Shower show you how to turn that old bath into an aisle of beauty and functionality. Our residential bathroom solutions provide the best value on the market, and our customer service is second to none. Our cost-effective BCI Bath & Shower family of products has what you need.
Remodeling our bathroom was a big decision for us.
They didn't make a mess out of our house at all. And at the end of the day, we had a beautiful new bathroom. And it was a great experience the whole way through.
We have the best monthly payment programs in the industry, with payments as low as $68 per month or no interest, no payments for 18 months. For a limited time, be one of the first 100 callers who schedule a free in-home consultation and receive $500 off. Call 1-800-594-9530. 1-800-594-9530. Factory-trained and certified installers made in the USA and discounts for seniors and military. BCI Bath & Shower, the leader in affordable bathroom products.
You're listening to House of Cards.
Your Majesty, the royal wrestlers await.
I'll bet on the little guy.
How much? 3,000 guineas, 2 geese and a duck. That's a foul bet.
Welcome back to House of Cards. Dave Weishottle with you. Football season is upon us, and that means a lot of sportsbooks are making moves and spending money to attract your business. Seems like something new is happening every day, and the deals are coming fast and furious. And as always, to keep us up to date with what's going on in the gambling world, we turn to our favorite returning guest from USBets.com and Better Collective. Adam Small is on the line with us right now. Adam, thanks for coming on.
Awesome to be back, Dave. It's good to be on the show. I've been doing this now for, I want to say, first time I came on with you guys was 4 or 5 years ago now.
Really?
So that pretty long? Cool that we've got such a long-standing relationship here.
Oh, it's always great to have you on, and especially this time of year. Like I said, football's here, and it seems everyone's excited about this. I mean, recently I was doing an interview with Scott Sabella, who's the president of Resorts World Las Vegas, and I wanted to ask him about his sports betting at the property and at the resort. I barely got the question out when he said, "We can't wait for football season." I mean, there's certainly big betting events in the year like March Madness and things like that. But in terms of sports betting, is football the king when it comes to revenue for a sports book?
Yes, and it's not close to anything else. The numbers that we experience, even just as a marketing partner for online sports books, are, I mean, it's basically like having a tourist season in a, you know, in a beach country or whatever, where you make all your money in 4 months out of the year. That's pretty much how it is. It's more like 6 months, I guess, when it's September through February, really, that you do really well. And it's really only a part of February, but the Super Bowl is so big that it basically becomes a whole month in February. But yeah, those 6 months are pretty much where you make all your money. You do okay in March with March Madness. You do okay with one-off type events and baseball and all that. But football is where all of it is at.
You know, I'm using the term football, but, you know, there's NFL football and there's NCAA football. I'm up here in New Jersey and, you know, we don't have a big college fan base. I mean, we have Rutgers and Princeton, but no one really, you know, really follows them on TV and things like that. You're down in the South where NCAA has some of the best teams in the country, you know, Clemson, Alabama, Tennessee, LSU. I'm very curious, sports books in the South, is NCAA betting better than NFL betting down there in terms of revenue, or is just everything is so rich for the sports books?
Well, it's a good question, and I think it's one that we probably don't have much data on yet, because as far as I can think of, Tennessee was the first state in the South, in the old South, I guess, to legalize and put operational online sports betting. And that was just in November of last year. So the college season was already kind of winding down at that point. And so we probably don't have a ton of data on that yet. Mississippi has had sports books for a couple of years, but that is in-person only or mobile on-premises. So it's not statewide mobile. That being said, I think there's a lot of logic to what you're saying. I can just tell you from personal experience living in Georgia that people around here don't care that much about professional sports. I always say that I think the Atlanta United are the most popular professional sports team in Atlanta ever since they've come into existence about 3 years ago. You see a lot of people wearing Atlanta United gear all around the city and metro area, but the Braves and the Falcons and the Hawks are kind of only marginally popular sports teams here compared to people's fanaticism about University of Georgia and Clemson and Alabama, for those who went somewhere like that, or South Carolina. Florida. It just seems like there are flags everywhere. Like in my neighborhood, which is pretty suburban, low key place, on any given Saturday, you see cars driving around with flags for any of those schools and others. And so I have to believe that betting would be more intense on college football here compared to NFL, at least, in proportion compared to what it would be up in the north.
Now, I know a lot of sports books are gearing up for the football season, and I know in New Jersey I'm starting to see a lot of Caesars commercials. I mean, and before we start talking about what they're doing for football season, I want to ask about something really big that just happened with Caesars. Recently, they acquired William Hill in the U.S., and I'm curious, what does that do for the sports betting landscape in this country?
Well, it's huge.
Yeah.
It's huge for a number of reasons. I think Caesars has been for many years kind of the flagship U.S. brick and mortar casino brand. I think others would, probably like to claim otherwise, and certainly can claim that they have more kind of elite properties like the Venetian and the Wynn in Las Vegas, and some of the things in City Center and now Resorts World and Circa and some of these other places. But the most known brand nationally has certainly been Caesars for a long time. And that's probably the biggest household name in gambling in the U.S. And so for them to acquire William Hill, which had the biggest footprint in terms of U.S. sports books, in terms of brick and mortar sports books in the U.S., and this is, dating back to before PASPA was overturned by the Supreme Court, when it was mostly just in Nevada. And William Hill just was operating a lot of different sports books on the ground there, had a lot of infrastructure in place, was well prepared, as well as, their European infrastructure that they'd built out and their online presence in Europe. So it was a really good match. William Hill has been spending a lot on marketing for sports betting over the last year or so, building up a pretty substantial user base in a number of states. They're still, quite a bit smaller than FanDuel and DraftKings and BetMGM so far, but they are relevant for sure. And they've been spending, opening up their purse. And I think their combination with Caesars and their declaration that they're going to spend $1 billion or whatever is a big deal. It's merging an already very competent operation with a brand that a lot more people in the U.S. around the country are very familiar with. Because I think a lot of people probably in the Las Vegas area are familiar with William Hill, but it's not super well known in the rest of the U.S.
Okay, hold that thought. We're going to take a quick break. See you on the other side.
Seniors with Medicare. This is an important announcement. Did you know you may qualify for a monthly Social Security rebate? Did you know you may qualify for a $0 monthly premium? That's right. You may qualify to get $135 added back to your Social Security check each month. Just call the Medicare Benefits Line to get your options. It's a free call. You may also qualify for $0 premiums, dental coverage, vision coverage, hearing coverage, and prescription drug coverage. With this type of plan, you don't need Medicare supplement insurance. Call now, because you deserve to get the most from your Medicare benefits, including a rebate to your Social Security check each month. Agents are standing by with free information regarding Medicare benefits. It's a free call with no obligation, but it could mean big savings for you. Call the Medicare Benefits Line now to see if you're eligible for a Social Security rebate.
Call 800-574-6770. 800-574-6770.
You're listening to House of Cards.
Where was the house? Where was the house of cards?
Welcome back to House of Cards. Dave Weishottle with you here. For those of you just joining us, I am talking with Adam Small from USBets.com and Better Collective. Sorry about that. Radio has to do its business, you know. Why don't you continue what you were saying before the break?
So I think they're going to be a big player. I think that, you know, a couple of years from now, as things get a little bit less, I would say, top heavy in terms of market share, or I think it's very unlikely, for example, that anyone's going to have 40% of the U.S. market for sports betting or anything like that. I think you'll see Caesars become one of the biggest players, and obviously their spending intentions make it even clearer that that is what they want to do and plan to actually put forth the resources to do. And on that note, I just should mention that, you know, Caesars has come out with a $5,000 risk-free bet as the first offer, which, I mean...
I am like, so glad you brought that up. Boy.
Yeah, I mean, it's part of the... I mean, it's a big deal. They were doing in back in February around the Super Bowl, and for a couple of months they were offering at William Hill 2021 as a max free bet, $2,021. And I think, you know, it's important to emphasize that the vast majority of new customers are not betting $2,000 on their first bet, which is what you have to do. You can't split it up. You've got to actually make a $2,000 bet. And then, you know, if it's risk-free, I think it's a risk-free bet. If you lose the bet, you then have a bonus bet of the same amount where you make the same full amount bet again. And if you win that, you basically, you know, are now ahead, I guess, right? You're ahead, not broken even. But yeah, I mean, it's very, it's a very large amount of money to risk still, because even if it's plus EV, a positive expected value, you are, you know, that's still 1 in 4 or whatever that you lose both bets and you're out your money. And once you put in for it, you're kind of stuck gambling with it all. So, it's an ambitious item. It's certainly a very costly one, that I doubt would be profitable on a per customer basis. Mm-hmm. But I think the point for them is that they really want to acquire these whales, these high volume bettors, these kinds of people that can afford and are comfortable depositing that much money and making bets that size, regardless of, you know, how they see the opportunity as a bettor to make or lose money. They want to be able to acquire the people just that have the means to deposit that much.
You know, I am fascinated to see what Caesars is doing. Like you said, they're going to invest $1 billion into marketing into their digital business. I know CEO Tom Reeg made a point of saying that they have 54,000 salespeople ready to hit the ground running for football season. And also this risk-free bet up to $5,000. I'm wondering, is Caesars setting the standard for the market as we enter this football season? I mean, are they putting pressure on other books to invest more money?
So I don't think they're setting the market in terms of the bonus. I don't believe that that's going to be like, you know, what everybody else is doing. We haven't really seen any evidence of that. They're certainly doing something head turning that nobody else has done to date. It's a big number, and we have seen some other operators upping their bonus amounts. I think that the standard is starting to become for the top tier operators to all be offering $1,000 risk free, you know, for new customers. We just saw BetMGM change their offer from 500 or from 600, sorry, to 1,000, which FanDuel and DraftKings have both been doing 1,000 for a while. So, I think, I mean, we are seeing that kind of pressure does exist. In that, you know, there is pressure for, you know, for operators to match what other operators are offering. But the $5,000 offer is so outlandish that it's like, I mean, it just seems like one of these big high risk, but also potentially high reward gimmicks that is probably going to get a lot of people in who see this offer and actually end up depositing like $200 and doing a risk-free bet for that amount or even less than that, but will catch a lot of people's eyes and, you know, invite a number of whale type players, as well as, you know, people like myself and other people I work with who would happily sign up and bet $5,000 under these circumstances, understanding the risks, but going for it because of the value of the promotion, and then probably not becoming the kind of players they want us to become after doing that. So, I mean, there is, you know, a fair amount of risk for them that they're going to get a lot of people like that as well.
You know, one thing that was very interesting about Caesars is you know everything there is to know about affiliate marketing, and we love talking to you about affiliate marketing, and we're in that realm too. And we were on a conference call with Caesars, and that was their big thing. It's called Bet Like a Caesar. And they're going to have a whole storyline. We're having their commercials on TV right now. I mean, J.B. Smoove is being Caesar. I know Patton Oswalt is going to be a character named Carl. And then they're going to have a character named Cleo, who I guess is Cleopatra. They haven't named the actress
right
yet. I mean, they want to make it a storyline throughout the football season. Is that how crucial football is to these sports books? Is that they're coming up with now almost like the old-fashioned serials before movies, that, you know, a continuation of a story?
Yeah, I mean, clearly a lot of thought has gone into all of this. And clearly they're not content to just be like an also involved type of player in this market. There's a lot of catch up to do still. And I think it's important to emphasize this, that these big brands, whether it's Caesars or, you know, one of the big European brands like Bet365 or Unibet, that have big plans and big spending mapped out for the U.S., regardless of what they do, they're not going to be able to catch up real quickly with a FanDuel or DraftKings, who have been building actual customer databases for a number of years now and just have a huge head start just in terms of the people that actually have accounts and have money on deposit and have their emails registered with them. So it is going to take a long time. But I do think that, you know, Caesars is making it very clear that they're ready to start getting serious about this, whereas prior to the William Hill acquisition, they were really very much on the sidelines. They'd only launched in a couple of states and weren't doing a whole lot of marketing at all, and their product was really low quality as well. So I think, you know, it's very clear that they're ready to start making a real run at it. Mm-hmm. But it's just going to take time. I think also, on the other hand, the view that, you know, FanDuel and DraftKings and BetMGM are just too far ahead is also very demonstrably incorrect. And you can just look at Europe as an example of how these markets do disperse in terms of people's share. Biggest difference in the U.S., of course, is that in most states, just participating at all or having control over whether or not you have market access is largely dependent on land-based casino presence. Mm-hmm. And that gives a big advantage to the companies that actually own casinos like Rush Street Interactive and Caesars and MGM and Hard Rock, I guess, and you know, takes some of the possibilities at times away from others that are looking to get involved, particularly a lot of these European brands that have historically only focused on online gambling, like the 888s and Bet365s and Unibets of the world. So, you know, I think that's all to say just that there's a lot that's still to shake out with all of this.
Yeah.
But when you see Caesars lining up to spend like this and other companies as well, it's certainly not just them, and these big media brands like, you know, Fubo getting involved and other big international brands like Betway and Bluebet coming in. It's very clear that there are a lot of people that still believe their story is just beginning in the U.S. And I think this football season is going to be the first one here in the U.S. where we really start to see a lot of different companies start to really open their pockets and bring their best people to this game.
Okay, hold that thought. We're going to take a quick break. See you on the other side.
owed the IRS $10,000.
The IRS garnished my wages.
They put a lien on my house.
I'm self-employed and didn't report all my income. They claim I owe a lot more than I do.
The IRS is the most powerful collection agency in the world. They do not give up until you pay.
I couldn't sleep. We were being audited. I called Tax Solutions Now, and a great big weight was lifted off my shoulders.
I called Tax Solutions Now, and they got the IRS off my back.
Tax Solutions Now had my wage garnishment lifted in 48 hours.
Tax Solutions Now can get you help. Our agents know the rules, can stop the pain, and get you the best deal.
Tax Solutions Now saved my business.
I qualified for the Fresh Start program. I paid less than I owed.
We connect you with a team of former IRS agents and tax professionals who get the IRS off your back.
Time is running out. Call Tax Solutions Now.
Call 800-297-9788. 800-297-9788.
Hey, this is Dave Weishuttle from House of Cards with your House of Cards Gaming Report for the week of August 23rd, 2021. Harrah's New Orleans became the first casino in the country to issue a vaccine mandate. The Caesars Entertainment-owned property announced that patrons need to show proof of vaccination or a negative test result to enter the casino. New Orleans Mayor LaToya Cantrell introduced vaccine mandates not only for the casinos, racetracks, and riverboats, but also for the Superdome. For the first time in history, a World Series of Poker bracelet was awarded in the state of Pennsylvania. The winner, with a screen name of Rat Rivers, won the bracelet playing the Keystone Kickoff Tournament. Not only did Rat Rivers take home the gold bracelet, but also won over $48,000 for the tournament win. And finally, a former NBA player may be in trouble because of his home poker games. According to reports, police obtained a warrant to search the home of former Memphis Grizzlies Antonio Burks to look for evidence of the illegal home games. The police found two large poker tables, chips, a surveillance system, a ledger with alleged gambling losses, and a lot of decks of cards which had the words Burks Poker Palace Rules on them. Burks was released on bond and is expected back in court on August 24th. Those printed cards might have been a really bad idea. Have any news or tips regarding casinos, gaming, or legislation? Send us an email at newsroom at houseofcardsradio.com and follow us on Twitter at HOC Radio.
You're listening to the House of Cards.
Knife. Knife. Not thrilling, but knife.
Welcome back to House of Cards. Dave Weishaupt with you. For those of you just joining us, I am talking with Adam Small from USBets.com and Better Collective. It's very interesting that you said media. I know the CEO of WinBet recently, Matt Maddox, said, you know, we're really stepping up our marketing and branding as we approach the 2021 NFL season. I mean, WinBet partnered with Cumulus Media, then WinBet partnered with a podcast network called Blue Wire Media. Is that what we're going to see pretty soon with a lot of these sports books? Their marketing plans includes partnering with media companies?
Yeah, I mean it's already happening, and it's been happening. I mean, FoxBet is probably the most widely known example, but you know, BetMGM partnered with Yahoo to become their official partner. That was like a couple of years ago now, I think. And I mean, you're seeing this more and more. You're seeing brands partner up with sports teams, brands partner up with media organizations. You look at Bally, which is really just getting started. I mean, they're another example, just this huge presence. They've got all these TV networks that are now, you know, Bally sports stations. I go to a Braves game here in Atlanta, and I see people wearing Bally attire everywhere. And there isn't even any gambling here in Georgia, other than the online lottery, I guess. But that's not gambling, right?
Yeah.
So, right. Yeah, I mean, I think it's so interesting how many players there are, the ever-expanding map of play. It feels like you're watching Game of Thrones sometimes,
yeah,
where the story just keeps expanding and never contracting and just becomes unwieldy. Like, how is this all going to play out? But, I think it's really interesting to note some of the moves that Penn National has made in the last couple of years and how savvy that they seem, as well as aggressive in a lot of ways to me, even if I'm not entirely confident that it's going to work out for them. I'm not that confident it's going to work out for them, but I'm really interested in it and think they've given themselves a real shot. Penn National is just this very large, but fairly kind of regionally known casino network based in Wyomissing, Pennsylvania, just outside Philadelphia. And they own a few casinos, several casinos around the country. But they kind of had this small online gaming presence in Pennsylvania with Hollywood Casino and not much else going on. All of a sudden they acquire a significant stake in Barstool Sports for, you know, a 9-figure sum of money. And all of a sudden they're not just Penn National, this, you know, holding company for a bunch of casinos or whatever anymore. They are Barstool, like a big media company. And then they're Barstool Sportsbook when they launched their own sports book. And now Penn National has acquired The Score for $2 billion.
What a bargain.
And, right. I mean, and The Score is another huge media network with radio programs all over the country, a lot of well-known personalities involved, based in Canada, a big Canadian presence. I think this deal was largely about the Canadian market, which is about to open up as a regulated market later this year.
Yeah.
But also about the US, where The Score has already launched in a few different states and has a lot of presence in the US as well. But Penn National strategy seems to be entirely media focused. They're not really doing anything else that I know of to acquire customers, very little affiliate marketing or anything like that. It's all about using media brands that they own or own a stake in to produce customers and revenue. That's their strategy. They've really made kind of a unique space for themselves. So I think, Bally is going to be very focused on that, using their own media to generate customers. Certainly we've seen some of that from Fox Bet, though not as much as I would think. And they're not in as many states as I would have thought they would be in yet. But, this is just going to be one of the various strategies that these big legacy casino companies use to try to be relevant in this space.
Like you said, Penn National and The Score Media was such a great acquisition for Penn National, especially right before football season. You have this market access in different states and also in Canada. I mean, do you think we're going to see, because of this deal, a bigger presence of Barstool Sports during the football season from Penn National?
I don't know if it's going to be because of this deal. I'm not sure how that's going to play out, because I guess they're still going to have likely these two different brands of U.S. sports books running. The Score, which is already live in, I believe, more states than Barstool. They're both in a few states now. But I think that we're going to see a lot of both. I'm not sure we're going to see them in the same ways that we're used to seeing, FanDuel, DraftKings, BetMGM, and others, where we're used to seeing a lot of billboards if you're in a gaming state, as you are, as I'm not. When I drive to Tennessee or whatever, I see the second I pass the state line, I see huge billboards for BetMGM, whatever else. They're all over Chattanooga, like, hey, welcome to Tennessee, go gamble. I don't think we're going to see as much of that for Barstool. I'm sure they're probably going to do some, but I think their strategy is largely on the spending they do internally on content and media and social media presence. And some of it just, it goes well beyond what I ever imagined, being a media proprietor of sorts myself, though obviously much, much smaller. Just like I was hearing this story the other day about this podcast that had been on Barstool, and I guess the two women or one woman who does this podcast got a deal with Spotify for millions and millions of dollars to move their podcast there instead of with Barstool. And Dave Portnoy was commenting on contract stuff or whatever on Twitter. Like, you know, he always comments on everything, but I was hearing about this, and it was like one of the top 20 podcasts in America in terms of listenership. And it was something I'd never heard of, and it was on a topic that seemed somewhat removed from what I would expect to be on Barstool. But it's like they've got tentacles that reach into all these places that I haven't even imagined, and they spend a lot of money on that, right? So where you look at FanDuel and DraftKings spending on TV ads, Barstool is spending on their own content and reach in just a different way, but also a very effective way.
You know, in the big gaming states, I mean, we always have the same players. We have the FanDuels, DraftKings, PointsBet, BetMGM. What have you heard from those major players that they're doing something special for the football season?
Well, everybody says they're going to spend a ton of money and grow a lot this year. That's for sure.
Yeah.
Beyond that, I mean, I haven't heard that much from those particular ones that you mentioned in terms of different plans this year.
I asked that because I haven't heard too much from them. FanDuel and PointsBet, I really haven't heard too much about what they're doing. I'm hearing about Penn National. I'm even hearing about smaller things like Tipico, who just made a deal with Gannett to provide data. But I'm not hearing anything about PointsBet. I'm not hearing anything about BetMGM or FanDuel. I mean, I'm just curious if you've heard of something. Am I missing something?
I haven't heard much, to be honest. I hear... definitely these declarations from some of the would-be up-and-comers, such as Caesars and WinBet. Mm-hmm. Those are the two that really popped over the last couple of weeks. The Caesars saying they're going to spend $1 billion, and WinBet saying, I believe they're going to spend, what is it, $500 or $600 million on acquisition coming up. It's some big amount of money. But I haven't heard a lot from the existing market leaders. You're right. PointsBet, I wouldn't categorize that way. Like FanDuel, it's definitely right now FanDuel, DraftKings, yep. BetMGM leading the way, certainly nationally and in most states as well. And I believe in some places BetMGM has actually pulled ahead of DraftKings. And I also believe BetMGM is at least nationally the top casino market shareholder right now. Though FanDuel is right there with them. I think PointsBet's an interesting one. I know Seth Young, who's been heading up marketing for them for a while, just took off and is headed somewhere new, which hasn't been announced yet. And so they've had a little bit of staffing changes. They still seem like they're ready to be pretty aggressive and want to grow a bunch, but they haven't really grabbed a ton of market share in the U.S. yet. They're doing well enough to justify, I guess, continuing. But it's interesting to not hear more from them about big plans for the season. I think over the next couple of weeks, you'll hear everybody coming out with some new offer, something special for the start of NFL. And it's a fun time to be a bettor because I'm sure you'll have a bunch of good reactivation offers and whatnot in New Jersey. Yeah. For me, it's like, every time I go to Tennessee, there's a couple new sports books that have launched that I haven't joined yet. So I always get a bunch of big free bets every time I'm up there I was in Pennsylvania recently, same thing. I joined Barstool for the first time and Unibet and a couple others and was able to take advantage of those new customer offers. So, it should be a fun month or so for bettors as well as people who promote the books.
Well, you mentioned smaller sports books or maybe less well-known sports books. I mean, I mentioned Tipico. I mean, certainly Tipico is a great sports book. We know people at Tipico, and I'll probably get email because of this. But they're not a household name like FanDuel or DraftKings. Is this putting pressure on the lesser-known sports books to spend a lot more money than they want to for this football season?
It's so hard to say because, you know, when they don't come out with announcements about this kind of stuff, it's hard to know what's really going on behind closed doors. Mm-hmm. But I mean, Tipico is an interesting example for me. We don't work with them yet. I mean, I'm sure we probably will at some point, but they're barely on my radar. Like,
yeah.
I don't really understand what they're doing in the U.S. I think they're only in New Jersey so far. And again, I always got to stress that it's so early. It feels, I think, because so many of the people that cover this industry were in poker before, including, both of us,
yeah,
I guess, to an extent, me very much. We're used to believing in this paradigm where eventually everything funnels up to one or two operators. Like there are a handful of winners, or maybe even just one or two winners in the U.S. before Black Friday and all that. It was Poker Stars and Full Tilt, really. And everybody else, while they might have been getting a bit of a share, was really relegated to not very important status in the U.S. and not taken very seriously. And eventually it really became only Poker Stars that you know, ran away with everything internationally for a while. And I think we're all used to kind of seeing that, to seeing those network effects where you're able to have much greater lifetime values for the customers you recruit when you have a lot of existing customers. And for poker and DFS, this is very important because you can just offer so much better things in terms of guaranteed prize pools and game selection and stuff like that. Poker and DFS are very similar in that regard. You can offer so much better things to your customers if you have a lot of them. And you know, it's a big part of the reason that online poker in the U.S. hasn't done that well so far, because we just don't have a lot of states combined playing together yet. But I think with sports betting, it's very different. The customer is betting against the house, an online casino as well. Whether it's one customer or 1,000 or 1,000,000 doesn't really change that much in terms of what the house can offer and you know, what that experience is like for the customer.
Okay, hold that thought. We're going to take a quick break. See you on the other side.
Heard? We don't need to hide anymore. Now, we can shop privately for adult products at adamandeve.com. They've got massage oils, lingerie, and lots more we can't mention here. Use offer code SPICE404. They'll give you 50% off almost any one item, 3 free DVDs, free mystery gift, and free shipping. That's 50% off, free shipping, and more. Private shopping starts at adamandeve.com.
You're listening to House of Cards.
I'm talking sick piles of money. I'm talking lay on your bed in your Vegas room, throw the money in the air, and dance as it showers down on you money. I'm talking frosted glass limo money. I'm talking big cowboy hat, silver turquoise buckle money. I'm talking gambling.
I am in love with you.
Welcome back to House of Cards. Dave Weishaupt with you. For those of you just joining us, I am talking with Adam Small from USBets.com and Better Collective.
Sorry about that. Radio has to do its business, you know. Why don't you continue what you were saying before the break?
I think that, you know, the people who believe that FanDuel and DraftKings have won and it's over, FanDuel, DraftKings, BetMGM, I mean, there are cautionary tales out there. BetMGM particularly is a really interesting one to me. I had a Twitter debate with someone from a competing media company that was saying basically there was a call like a year, maybe a year and a half ago with BetMGM, what GVC, I guess, which is now called Entain, the European parent of or part parent of BetMGM along with MGM in the U.S. And they were saying that they wanted to get to 5% share in the U.S. or 10%, I think it was 10% share in the U.S. within some amount of time. And this person on Twitter was scoffing at this, and I was responding, well, you know, let's see what they do. They've got some really good personnel, like it's early in the game. And sure enough, BetMGM is well beyond 10% now. People just didn't believe it was possible at that time because they'd basically been a part of the Borgata operation before that was pretty incompetent at online gaming for a while. And then they decided to get serious after PASPA, and everything changed. And I think, you know, people that think that 365, for example, isn't going to be relevant in the U.S. are kidding themselves. Bet365 crushes all kinds of places in the world. They're certainly the biggest private sports betting company in the world. They very much, you know, quote unquote, know what they're doing, and they're not going to come spend money on market access and operating in the U.S. just to, you know, be a third tier player. They're small right now, but you've got to believe that at some point they're going to be very relevant. Now, when you talk about a Tipico, or, you know, I just heard about Bluebet entering. I mean, I was barely familiar with them until they said they're coming into Arizona and plan to be in other states. I'm less sure, because these are definitely successful European brands. Betway is another one. Unibet is another that's been in the U.S. a bit more. Betway just came in. Betfred came in fairly recently. These are all pretty big companies outside the U.S., but it just, I think it really depends on how much they're able to become relevant brands in the U.S. to get their product to stand out, to get their marketing to stand out in a way that they get enough customers to matter. Some of those guys are going to fail. There's just no way that all of them get a really significant place in the U.S. So Tipico is one to me that I don't fully understand what's going on there, but they're so new to the market that, you know, who knows, maybe they'll figure it out and they'll be huge and we'll all be blown away. I just haven't seen anything yet to make me think that so far.
Now, you've touched a little bit on this before. I mean, we've been talking about these deals and these marketing plans that benefit the sportsbooks themselves, but what does all this activity by the sportsbooks mean for the consumer? They're giving all this attention-grabbing activity. They're throwing it out there. And I'm of the opinion, hey, more competition's better for the sports better. What do you think?
I think it's great for the sports better. I love it. For me personally, I love when I go to a state, like I was saying before, and there are new options to choose from. They almost always have new bets. I was even in Oregon recently, where there's a state monopoly, but I signed up for the Oregon lottery and got to take advantage of their free bet offer, which was like $100. It wasn't as good as the ones elsewhere, but I still did it. I think that all of these guys coming in, all of these different operators, put more and more pressure on the operators at the top to continue to be agile, to improve their offerings, to improve their bonuses and odds boosts and everything else that gets people excited about keeping money on their sites and betting. And I think it's great for customers. I think that these periods of rapid investment and rapid growth are awesome for customers. It's the best thing ever if you're a bettor who wants to actually make money playing, that all the books are fighting over land and not worrying about profitability. So as long as that's going on, it's going to be awesome to be a bettor. It's going to be awesome to be a marketer or to be a media entity like, you know, ESPN, who basically everyone thinks will eventually be a sportsbook brand, but right now probably just makes money, you know, hand over fist just by running ads. So, you know, I think that it's a really good time to be anybody who is attached to this industry.
Adam, we're running out of time, but can you give out your websites where we can keep up with all the gambling and sports betting news that seems to be constantly breaking every day?
Yeah, absolutely. And thanks for giving me the chance. Sportshandle.com is where you can get all of the latest legislative and industry news for sports betting. I really think that our site, you know, my clearly unbiased opinion, but I really believe that we are the top place covering that. Certainly the top place that's not behind a paywall covering these updates. We've also got usbets.com, which covers the whole industry, casino, sports betting, poker, all of it for the U.S., and a number of state-based websites, including NJ Online Gambling for New Jersey, PennBets for Pennsylvania, MidBets for Michigan, and a few others in some of the smaller states. And we'd love if you come by and check out our content, and really appreciate that.
Adam Small from USBets.com and Better Collective, as always, thank you for coming on and giving us your insight into some of the biggest gambling stories out there. Please come back on soon, because you always give us some great information.
Thank you, Dave. It's always awesome to be on.
Oh, thank you. Well, that'll do it for us this week. I'll see you next time on House of Cards.
Build a house of cards.